Welcome, listeners, to the Everlasting Stories podcast, presented by Sic Semper Serpent Books in Minneapolis, Minnesota. I'm your host, Michael Strand. It's a rainy night here in Minneapolis, the perfect evening to read for you the second entry in the case files of Detective Luke Miller by D. Zane Davis. This episode titled, Grendel's Ghastly Grandmother. In the previous episode, we met our hero, Detective Luke Miller, his talking dog Shelby, his ex-wife Natasha, and his daughter, Annika. We learned that though Luke is a pretty good private eye, things have been tough recently, and he hasn't had a good case, which is why he simply could not resist when the mysterious archaeologist, Dr. Dahlia Harriet, walked through his door offering him $250,000 to find Beowulf's lost sword, Nägeling. Luke took the case, he found that sword, and defeated the ghost, Dr. Lambert, who had stolen it. So, listeners, in tonight's episode, you'll meet a few familiar characters, a couple of new ones, and follow Luke as he confronts a brand new menace lurking in the dark corners of the Twin Cities Metro. If you would like to support this podcast, head over to patreon.com/sicksemperserpent and sign up. It's easy to do. For just $1 a month, you can get access to the entire written archive, and the $3 a month level gets you early access to new episodes of this podcast weeks before anyone else. Well, listeners, it's time to begin the story. This is Detective Luke Miller and Grendel's Ghastly Grandmother by D. Zane Davis. Heat waves rippled above the asphalt ocean surrounding the Mall of America's vast archipelago. Wheeled vessels frantically swirled in and out of numerous bays and inlets, their license plate ports of call ranging from Minnesota to Manitoba. Smeared against the window, Philip Niederhofer's spirit longed to sail that concrete estuary back to his home in Richfield. Unfortunately, his Saturday shift at a certain Swedish furniture retailer had barely begun. His wishful reverie was abruptly interrupted by a petite, hazel-eyed blonde. "I'm looking for this one rocking chair," Natasha Vinokurova Miller began, hands slung in the pockets of her gray hoodie. "I saw it in the catalog. It's called the Gramdahl or something thereabouts." Philip's faux enthusiasm was worthy of the theater. "Oh, yes, ma'am, I know exactly the one. Follow me." He felt relieved the customer wasn't interested in small talk as they made their way to the other end of the showroom. As they came upon the living room section, some North Dakotan's voice blared out like a klaxon horn. "Grandadel," it wheezed, examining a swooping construction of steel and wicker. "Granaldel? Jeepers, Marty, why can't they just call it a rocking chair?"
"Oh, it's a Grendel, dear," her husband Marty clarified.
"A Grendel?
the woman tried out the Swedish, like a poorly fitting pair of nylons. A Grendel? A Grenendel? A Gren... Her final attempt was interrupted by a deafening blast from above. There was a rush of air, a blinding flash, and a shriek like an igniting jet engine. The building shook, knocking everyone to the floor in a shower of concrete, dust, and insulation. For a moment, Natasha thought that an airplane attempting to land at the neighboring Minneapolis-St. Paul International Airport had fallen short of its runway and smashed into the store. Philip might have incorrectly assumed the same had he lived long enough to do so. However, his last second of life ticked away, pinned down by a pair of razor-sharp claws and staring into a set of deep crimson eyes. Private Eye Luke Miller arrived at Natasha's house that afternoon, after the police had finished their interviews. His ex-wife immediately offered him a cup of coffee, which suggested that whatever had happened was serious. He accepted the offer, though he hoped she wouldn't notice that he wouldn't drink it. Luke had never figured out why, but Natasha's coffee always tasted like she'd used an unwashed gym sock for a filter.
"They're saying it was a gas leak, ignited by static electricity," she said, her white mug rattling against its saucer.
"Jesus," Luke spoke to the tepid tan contents of his mug. "What a terrible way to die. I'm sorry, Tosh."
"An explosion would have been horrible," she whispered, her trembling hand causing the coffee in her mug to ripple. "What happened at the mall was not an explosion."
Luke looked up, locking his gaze with her massive hazel eyes.
"That employee, he wasn't blown up," she continued. "He was dismembered by some creature."
"Creature?" Luke tried not to sound incredulous. He failed. Her eyes fell into her coffee.
"The police said the gas caused us to hallucinate."
Tears dripped into her cup.
"Luke, I may have spent most of my education in conservatories, but I know natural gas doesn't cause you to see things like that."
"Like what?" Luke pressed.
"The thing. It was so black. It was more a void than an object."
Her voice shook, and her caramel irises boiled with terror.
"It was big, Luke. Big like a Clydesdale. But it stood on two legs, I think. I can only be sure of two features. It had fangs. They were pale as death and long as carving knives."
"And the second?"
"Its eyes."
She rested her clattering cup on her thigh, but her thigh also quivered.
"They were big as saucers and red. Red like the center of a blast of those 50s atomic test movies. It just appeared, Luke, out of nowhere. This older couple was looking at a Grondahl rocking chair, and then there was a blinding flash and a deafening scream, like something out of that movie, Cretaceous Park. I thought a plane had fallen short of the runway, but then I saw this thing attack the employee."
She stopped and shuddered to herself.
"Do you remember when Shelby caught that bunny? And then we found pieces of it all over the yard?"
Her voice shattered like glass crashing into a hardwood floor. Luke rose to comfort her. He didn't exactly know how to comfort her, this woman who'd thoroughly dismantled his heart, though he didn't also know how he could not comfort her. The woman who'd been his first true love. The woman who'd mothered his child. Though they hadn't so much as hugged in 5 years, her body still felt familiar against his own.
"It's good that Annika was with your mother, huh?" Luke soothed.
His ex-wife nodded into his chest. An incongruity manifested in his mind. "Wait, did she take Annie out of town?" Her head shook no. "You've always called your mother in times like these."
"I've never had a time like this," Natasha said,
looking up, with glistening rivulets drying upon her cherubic cheeks. "You know what I mean," Luke clarified. "But even if you couldn't talk to her, why not call Ben?" His replacement's name tasted bitter on his tongue.
"Both would agree with the police," she sighed. "They'll think I hallucinated the whole thing."
She preempted his next question.
"Luke, I called you because you're the only person I hoped might believe me."
Luke said he believed her. He wasn't lying. From his humid efficiency in St. Paul's Midway, Luke dialed Police Sergeant Mike Tomlinson. While Mike worked for the Minneapolis PD, his ears were good enough to catch gossip as far south as Northfield, so he was an excellent source of information for Luke's investigations. Mike said that he'd return Luke's call when he knew more. However, when Luke's phone buzzed about 20 minutes later, an ant's leg would have made more noise walking than the cop's voice had talking into the receiver. The hushed tone of Mike's usually thunderous speech alerted Luke that the information must have been top secret.
"Luke, I can hardly believe what them Bloomington boys told me, and they showed me the pictures. Gosh, it looks like that guy got attacked by something out of Jaws,"
Mike said in his thick Minnesotan accent. "Huh, so there was no gas leak?" Luke pried.
"Oh, well, that's what's even weirder. All the witnesses told my buddy that the guy got mauled by this big black animal. And then about an hour later, fellas from the DOT's Pipelines and Hazardous Materials Safety Administration showed up with some feds, and they took over. And then they told my buddy to forget the whole thing. They said that it was a natural gas explosion and the leak had created such a high concentration of fumes that it made people hallucinate."
"Wow, that's crazy," Luke remarked.
"Oh, that ain't the half of it. Them feds, they didn't just give them that, you know, crap explanation. They threatened them with it. Yeah, if any cop repeated anything about a creature, you know, a monster, you know, some malevolent entity, they said they'd face federal charges of slander, perjury, conspiracy, and obstruction of justice."
"Wait, wait, those charges make no sense," Luke interjected.
"Yeah, the feds always assume us beat cops are dumb. But right or wrong, them feds are still the feds. Like, I don't know where you caught wind of this, but I suggest you leave it where you found it."
"Oh, sure, Mike."
"Of course you won't. If you knew how to do that, you'd still be on the force, huh?"
"Yeah, right," Luke sighed. "Well, if anyone asks, I didn't hear any of this stuff from you."
"Hear what?"
Luke ended the call. He slumped back in his chair and opened his laptop. Scrolling through social media, he considered Mike's advice. Maybe he should drop the whole thing. Natasha had removed her armor for the first time in half a decade. Perhaps this was his chance to patch things up. Maybe they could rebuild a piece of the friendship that had united them in the first place. Reconciliation would certainly make raising Annie less stressful. But who knew how long Natasha would leave her defenses down? Maybe he should check up on her. He picked up his phone to call her when he was distracted by a post on his feed in the Frogtown Neighbors group. The post read, "A dozen patrol cars on Thomas near Milton. Anybody know what's going on? I'm on the police scanner," someone with a profile picture of the St. Paul City flag commented in response. "Sounds like somebody got mauled by a big dog. Officers in pursuit. OMG, so sad. I keep saying people to put their dogs on leashes," a toddler's face replied. "Our tax dollars at work," a large walleye answered. "Next time there's a shooting, I'll say a dog did it," someone joked. "Those pit bulls are a menace," an elderly face interjected. "I know it's not politically correct, but those junkyard dogs don't belong in a residential neighborhood." A video appeared below the woman's rant, which read,
Wasn't no pit bull. Got a security camera on my garage. You gotta see this.
Luke's phone fell from his hand and hit the floor. He watched, open-mouthed, as an SUV-sized specter sprinted across his laptop screen. Natasha's words describing the creature at the mall rang in his ears as he watched and rewatched the clip. Amid the inky blur, he could discern little more than its size and a massive pair of seething crimson eyes. As he clicked to download the video, however, an error message flashed. He reloaded the page, only to find the entire post and comment thread deleted. He had to investigate this mystery for himself, but carefully. His bronze-green, disco-era roadster bicycle seemed like the most discreet transportation option. Twilight fell as he approached the scene, squad car light bars sending blue and red dancers reeling across the darkening sky. Crime scene tape gated Thomas at Chadsworth and Milton, and both Edmund and LaFond. Luke slipped down an alley. Between gawkers, he caught sight of a white sheet spread over a lump lying between two cruisers. SPPD ordered the crowd to disperse. Luke backtracked, trying to find the alley from the video. He locked his rear brake as his vision registered something lying in a patch of thick, unkempt weeds between a clapboard garage and the jagged asphalt. The beam of his bike headlight confirmed it was a human's left hand and forearm, though the rest of the human it belonged to was missing. Slumping back in horror, he tripped over the bike he'd forgotten he was astride and slammed onto the pavement. He would have picked himself up had a police officer not spared him the trouble. The room Luke found himself exuded hospital more than police station, save for the handcuffs. Luke had told Officer Thau that they were unnecessary, but the chiseled Hmong American insisted he was only following orders. Luke believed him and expected a large federal agent in a crew cut to stride through the door and rough him up at any moment. He felt a little sexist when a red-headed woman entered instead. She was petite, even when compared to someone like Natasha, but she didn't carry herself like it. She strode across the room and slapped a manila folder on the table, unfastening the single button on her inexpensive but tailored black blazer. She planted herself in the chair across from Luke. Her facial features were round and gentle, but her expression was firm and emotionless, as though she were cut from marble. Even her hair, drawn into a tight, shimmering bun, appeared to be part of the sculpture. Her eyes, however, were wholly different, green as spring buds. They seemed to possess a life independent of their owner. The ivy in her irises wriggled and danced as she sized up the detective. "Thank you for your patience, Mr. Miller." Her voice matched her presence.
"And to whom do I have the pleasure of speaking?"
Luke's voice was saccharine. "Special Investigator Fry, FBI," she replied.
"FBI, huh? That's fancy. You got a badge?" Luke shot back.
"I wouldn't have made it in this room without one, Mr. Miller."
"Oh, obviously," Luke answered. But can I see it?"
Her gaze dropped to the folder. She opened it and studied the document on top for a moment. Then she looked back up and continued, "Do you smoke, Mr. Miller?"
"Oh, me? On occasion," Luke replied.
"But if you're offering, no thank you, because I presume it's laced with knockout gas or something."
"Hmm. Suit yourself."
She drew a blue pack of cigarettes and sparked one with an old-fashioned lighter so worn its case was mostly bare brass. Then she slid the pack across the faux wood tabletop. "If you change your mind," she said, and her badge followed it. A pallid mugshot of Agent Olivia Fry looked up at him, its expression only slightly more lively than that of the real person. Luke decided to risk a cigarette. The ghost of an eagle still barely clung to the lighter's brass.
101st Airborne,
Luke inhaled from behind the cigarette.
"Yes, my great-grandfather was in the 506th Parachute Infantry Regiment when he jumped over Saint-Mère-Glise on D-Day. That
was in his pocket. Hell of a story. Luke snapped the lid shut. He built a pyramid with her badge as a base and the cigarette pack and lighter as its sides and slid the construction back across the table. If you like that story so much, Mr. Miller, Fry replied, returning the items to her jacket pockets, why don't you tell me one? Can you explain what you were doing in that alley tonight? Oh, I was just out for an evening ride, Luke answered casually. Really, Mr. Miller, down a poorly lit, poorly paved alleyway? Yeah, sure, it's a shortcut. Her eyes dissected his smug expression. She exhaled a lungful of smoke and spoke curtly. Let me cut to the chase, Mr. Miller. We know that you're a private investigator and that you were in that alley for a reason. Regardless of who you're working for, how much you think you know, or where you've gotten your information, your investigation stops right here, right now. Do you understand? Okay, investigation into what? Luke inquired, smugness leaking into his voice. You tell me, Mr. Miller. All right, I see how it is, Luke declared arrogantly. Well, I got nothing to say, and you've got nothing to hold over me. So, I know my rights, and this conversation is over. Agent Fry's Ivy Irises iced over. She removed a paper from the folder and slid it across the table. It was an affidavit, apparently signed and dated by Luke, confessing to the murder and dismemberment of a one Mr. Philip Niederhofer and Mr. Donald Mayer. Luke attempted to act unaffected. He failed. You're going to frame me? For murder? Why? Oh, I certainly hope not, she replied, with a terse smile, taking the paper back. I mean, you're a clever man, Mr. Miller. I suspected that negotiations wouldn't be enough to ensure your cooperation without a very real consequence should you fail to comply with our demands. What demands? That you reveal everything and everyone you know connected to this case and agree never to speak a word about it or this meeting to another soul for as long as you live, she pronounced methodically before removing a stapled packet of forms from the folder and licking her pen. Luke's face could have been the first image result from an internet search for incredulous. However, before he could reply, the door opened. Agent Fry, another agent interrupted. Mm-hmm, she hummed in response, eyeing her paperwork again. Mr. Miller's lawyer is here. Luke barely managed to react as if he had a lawyer, but he had contacted absolutely no one. Tell them to wait. Her voice was like glass. But Matt, something cut the man's sentence short. Fry turned around in time to see him go limp and fall. Before his body hit the floor, Inspector Fry drew her gun, and she leveled it at Dr. Dahlia Harriet, who stood in the doorway behind the prone agent. Far from being his lawyer, Dr. Harriet was the reincarnation of Freya, goddess of love, war, and beauty. She had employed Luke once before when she paid him a hefty sum to help procure Beowulf's lost sword, Nagling. Dr. Harriet waved a hand at the pistol. The gun unloaded itself, its magazine tumbling to the tile. The rest of the pistol followed a second later, its metallic parts clattering to the floor in harmless bits. Inspector Fry fumbled a quivering hand down her collar, her eyes wide with fear. She retrieved a minuscule crucifix and held it out as far as its chain would allow. Oh, I am not a vampire, darling, Dr. Harriet cooed. She turned to the detective. It's nice to see you again, Luke. Her gaze instantly warmed his soul. She waved her hand again, and this time his handcuffs clicked open. Likewise, Luke replied, rubbing his wrists and wondering whether he should be shocked by her sudden appearance. Though, no offense, doesn't killing a federal agent violate your whole God shouldn't interfere in human affairs philosophy? Oh, he's merely unconscious, Dr. Harriet shrugged, having the best dreams of his life, in fact.
He'll be right as rain in a few hours.
I could use some good dreams right now, Luke bemoaned.
How'd you know I was in trouble?
She cocked her head, her smile suggesting the answer was obvious.
Your dog, Shelby, contacted me.
Really?
Well, if that don't beat all, I guess it would be an understatement to call a telepathic dog man's best friend.
Oh, indeed. After overhearing your phone conversation, she was concerned that you did not return home. I must admit, Luke, based on what she's told me, I'm quite concerned that something extremely sinister is at work here.
So are we, Fry announced, dropping her crucifix back inside her collar.
Really? Because it seems to me like you're more concerned with framing innocent bystanders for heinous crimes.
Luke's tone was acidic.
Just threats, Fry said, almost apologetically, her eyes focused on the bristling black swan looming over her.
Can you imagine the chaos this story would create if it hit more than just the tabloids?
I won't deny the difficulty of your position, Dr. Harriet remarked frigidly. But right now, I need you to tell me everything the Bureau knows. So far, I've only got the second-hand account of a telepathic house pet.
Inspector Fry and Luke shared their respective accounts. Absorbing both stories, Dr. Harriet eased herself into a chair. An immense weight was visible upon her shoulders.
I had rather hoped my suspicions were wrong, she began. Luke, have you read Beowulf since our last meeting?
He shook his head. Her look of disappointment stung like a paper cut to Luke's heart.
All right. Recall that Beowulf made his name by killing two monsters. The first was Grendel. This beast eviscerated and devoured a dozen of the finest great warriors before Beowulf tore his arm clean out of its socket. Wounded, Grendel escaped the battle but died shortly thereafter.
Grendel's destruction sparked an assault by his mother, an even fiercer fiend. She julianned another brace of elite warriors before Beowulf tracked her to her lair and beheaded her, ending the terror.
But, Luke interjected, knowing there was more to the tale, but Grendel's family line extended beyond two generations. Grendel's grandmother, a monster more horrific than both her progeny combined, knew the fates were against her. She knew she could not defeat Beowulf in a single combat, so she prayed to Hel, god of death, and Hel listened. Hel allowed her to dwell in the underworld, be it 1,000 years or more. Only when summoned by the living, by the mouth of a mortal, would she return to our world to wreak her revenge upon all those who bore Geat blood.
The blood of Geat warriors, huh?
Perhaps that's why she seems to select her victims, Inspector Fry interjected.
Exactly.
So, Luke began, his lungs heavy, how do we kill it? Dr. Harriet smiled sadly, light bouncing off her irises like waves upon a quiet ocean.
Her deal with the god Hel makes the answer rather difficult.
That deal being what?
That only Beowulf's blade can banish her back to Hel.
You mean? Luke slumped backward, closing his eyes. He'd nearly lost his life finding that sword 6 months earlier, when Freya had enlisted him to stop a professor's ghost and his sinister cult from using it to take over the world.
Yes, Dr. Harriet said quietly. Nagling must be remade.
Though her story seemed completely absurd, the obvious magical abilities of Dr. Harriet convinced Inspector Fry to accompany them to retrieve the ancient sword. Dr. Harriet drove all three to her palatial home, where they collected the rusty shards of Nagling, along with the late Professor Lambert's anthology of Saxon magic. Then they set off through the dark city towards her office at the University of Minnesota. As of now, the sword requires a human sacrifice to be remade to its former glory, Dr. Harriet said as she navigated her luxury SUV through traffic. But a colleague has some Welsh tablets that might help us. Their magic is older and stronger, might be able to remake the blade without the need to spill mortal blood. Luke was about to comment when his phone rang. It was Natasha. Oh, shoot. He'd forgotten to check on her, and he braced for a sharp rebuke.
Hello, Luke? Luke?
Her voice sounded fearful and desperate.
Luke, we're trapped.
What? He stammered.
Luke, we're in the car. Ben, Annie, and me. We were coming home from my mother's, but it followed us.
What?
It's the creature.
Her voice broke. Luke could almost hear the tears cascading off her cheeks. Look, we're on our way. Call the police, all right? His heart nearly clogged his mouth.
I did, and they thought it was just a prank. Hurry, please, help before it opens my car like a tuna can.
The call ended sharply. Luke hoped on purpose. The monster, it's attacking my ex, Natasha. Where? Dr. Harriet barked. He shouted directions at her, and Dr. Harriet buried her foot in the SUV's carpet, squealing the tires. Why would the creature go after Tash? Her family is Belarusian. Luke's voice was taut as a piano wire as they rocketed down the asphalt.
What about her boyfriend? Dr. Harriet pressed. Is he Scandinavian?
Oh, yeah, I think so, Luke replied. Tosh was telling me that they were planning on visiting some of his relatives in Gotland, Sweden, sometime next summer. Members of the tribe that once inhabited Gotland are known as Gautar in Old Norse, or Geat in Anglo-Saxon.
Oh, Jesus, Luke said.
A carpenter is of no use to us now, darling. They squealed around a South Minneapolis corner 5 minutes later, directly towards a massive black mass in the roadway. The demon sucked the light right out of the SUV's headlamps as they approached too fast to stop.
Hold on,
shouted Dr. Harriet, her voice like iron as she swerved directly into the creature. The engine whined like a pouncing jungle cat, tires screamed like an injured coyote, and steel crumpled like an empty beer can. Glass exploded as though hit by a 12-gauge shotgun. The remains of the SUV, including its new demonic hood ornament, jumped the curve and careened into a colossal silver maple 100 yards down the block, and they hit it hard, causing the tree to shudder. Luke's head spun amid deflating airbags and bits of tempered glass. He saw Inspector Fry tug at her seatbelt up front, and then Natasha's concerned face appeared in the glassless window beside him. He opened the door and half fell onto the pavement, the black mass haunting his periphery.
Tash, he yelled, interrupting whatever she was shouting. It's not dead. Grab Annie, grab Ben, get to the basement, barricade every door.
Preempting further explanation, a pair of red beacons ignited in the dark night ahead of them.
Run!
Natasha didn't argue. The creature forced the carcass of the SUV backwards, the open passenger door nearly hitting Luke. It screamed and lurched towards the detective, but gunshots echoed into the night air. Inspector Fry darted in front of Luke, pouring rounds into the abyss of the monster's body as it barreled after her. One house down, Luke saw Natasha and Ben carry Annika inside. He then turned his attention to the ruined SUV, looking for the sword. Inside, the position of Dr. Harriet's head and neck made it clear that Freya's spirit would require a new incarnation. He dove into the wreck, retrieved the rusted hilt of the Nagling, and bolted after the beast. He didn't have far to run. Luke intercepted the monster as it streaked back towards Natasha's house, ducking behind a parked car to keep out of its sight. There, he found Special Inspector Fry, her top half anyway. Her green eyes flickered like the lamps of a sinking ship.
You needed a sacrifice, right?
Her voice choked as she vomited blood.
Tell my wife.
Then the lamps went dark. Luke was too panicked to notice the tears pouring down his cheeks. Maybe Fry's blood would do, but there was no time to use it. He had to stop Grendel's grandmother from murdering his wife and child. Even Ben didn't deserve to die that way. He caught up with the beast outside of Natasha's house. It stamped and stared intently at the picture window. She could Juliana Carr, he thought. What's the problem with a pane of glass? Then he noticed it. The pale incandescence from the street lamp perfectly reflected the monster's deathly image in the window. Oh, she's afraid of her own reflection, he whispered to himself. The car's window must have done the same thing. Go figure. She's smart enough to make a deal with the devil, but dumber than Shelby when faced with a mirror. Quickly, Luke formulated a plan. He didn't know if it would work, but he knew he had just one chance. With the monster distracted, he retrieved Professor Lambert's book and the remaining sword shards from the SUV wreck. Down the road, he tossed the rusty fragments into the puddle of blood forming under what was left of Inspector Fry. The spell he needed was still bookmarked. Evil though the old professor had been, Luke was grateful he'd translated the words into modern English. Luke's voice croaked hoarsely. Taker of blood, now blood receive. Mortal metal, divine breath reforge. Sword in hand, great Odin, this king your faithful thane will forever be. An artillery shell might as well have landed beside him. He squinted as a flash of light so white a lily would have wilted in shame dissipated into inky darkness. Before him, Luke beheld a sword glittering on the asphalt. If he stuck the tip into the ground, its pommel would touch Natasha's forehead. She was 5'1". He'd never lift a sword of that size, but he'd come too far not to try. To his astonishment, the sword seemed to weigh nothing. He'd held heavier feathers. He'd have to believe it later. He ran back to the house, brandishing the blade like a Saxon warrior. He didn't get very far. The creature swung an elephantine paw, throwing him to the ground. The massive sword clattered from his grasp. Foam dripped from the fangs of the beast, white as bleached bones. Its claws rent his chest so deeply you could plant potatoes in the furrows. The sword lay 6 inches too far to grasp. He prayed that death would be quick, but he knew it wouldn't be.
Hey, Natasha's voice suddenly barked from the front door. Why don't you pick on someone your own size?
The monster's head followed the rapport, losing its grip slightly. Luke snatched the hilt and swung the blade upward. It met the demon's throat. The monster's blood flowed the color of Fry's eyes and hot enough to boil eggs. The demon shrieked like a massive dying pig. The beast turned and bolted towards Natasha, but Luke leapt onto its back. He couldn't tell if it had scales, fur, or bare skin. All he knew was that the sensation of touching it filled him with otherworldly terror and nausea. Knowing that this was his only chance, he plunged nagging between the shoulders of the beast with as much force as he could muster. Grendel's grandmother balked and reared up with a cry that would haunt anyone in earshot for the remainder of their life. For several moments, it stumbled back and forth like a drunken demonic party guest. Finally, it collapsed into an immense lifeless heap in Natasha's front yard, the world's most hideous lawn ornament. Luke barely had time to dismount the slain beast before Natasha's embrace nearly suffocated him. What the hell were you thinking? Luke chided. That thing could have cut you to ribbons.
I would have let her grind me in the glitter if it kept our baby safe.
The determination in her hazel eyes verified her statement contained no hyperbole.
Daddy killed the mean doggy,
Annika pronounced from Ben's arms. The bearded Swede was usually ruddy, but his face had drained to white. Ben started speaking, but Luke's brain turned to another channel. He looked down and noticed that his shredded Led Zeppelin shirt was fit for a hair metal video, but there was no trace of the creature's claws on his skin. Though they had carved into him deep enough to show his ribs, Luke's chest could now star in a body wash commercial. The only blood on him was of that of the monster.
The monster's blood, he interrupted.
Tosh, I need a bowl, quick. One you won't miss. Ben, you come with me. They laid out the late Dr. Harriet onto the sidewalk while Luke collected some of the boiling green blood from the slain beast. He poured the bubbling emerald contents of the bowl onto her neck and shoulders. Then a gruesome crackling of bone and tendon emanated from beneath the woman's skin. A second later, she gasped as though she'd been holding her breath, and her blue eyes nearly blinded the detective as her lids opened again.
"In all my lifetimes," she purred, after gaining her bearings, "this is the first time I've ever been saved by a mortal. I was wrong, Luke. You don't have the potential to be a warrior like Beowulf. You have the potential to be the consort of a goddess."
Even bathed in cryptid blood, Dr. Harriet's sublime beauty inspired Luke to imagine what consorting with her might be like. She read his expression, smiled, and changed the subject.
"How did you manage to restore the sword?"
Luke's sudden change in countenance left explanation redundant. Down the road, they delicately reassembled Inspector Fry's body. As the demon's blood touched it, her two halves melted back together as if she were made of wax. As the FBI agent quietly blinked back into consciousness, she studied Luke and Dr. Harriet for what felt like an age. Luke read the question in her eyes.
"You didn't finish saying what I was supposed to tell your wife," Luke said to her kindly.
She smiled and shook her head.
"Take good care of Martin, our little boy. He's about your daughter's age, actually."
She felt around on her stomach, as surprised as Luke to find no trace of the creature's claws.
"You know," she said, incredulous, "I think that stuff erased my C-section scar, too."
Luke would have replied had a police officer not stuck a pistol in his face. He forgave the officer's insensitivity. After all, if Luke had found a trio soaked with blood near a car wreck, a horrific animal carcass, and a sword that looked like it belonged in a Final Fantasy cosplay, he would have pulled his gun too.
"It's all right, officer," Fry answered, gathering her badge from her pocket.
"I'm with the FBI, and they're with me." It appears that the driver of the vehicle was several times over the legal limit when he hit the tree, Inspector Fry explained to a local television reporter on the next morning's news. Of course, we can't confirm this assumption without further investigation. However, we do know that the vehicle in question was reported stolen from a residence near Lake Minnetonka several days ago. The broadcast cut back to the studio, and Natasha hit mute.
"Very convincing, Inspector," Luke announced.
Unguarded, Fry's manner was almost timid.
"Oh, let's just hope the cover sticks. In the meantime, I best be going."
Her voice shrunk.
"It was nice to meet you, Annie."
And then she turned to her host. "Thanks for the cup of coffee, Miss Vinokurova." Even the FBI agent's stoic features couldn't fully conceal the fact that Natasha's coffee was irredeemable.
"Mr. Miller, Dr. Harriet, I can never thank you enough. I'd say goodbye, but I have a feeling this isn't the last time you'll be hearing from the FBI."
As the door clicked behind Fry, Dr. Harriet rose.
"I should go as well. Luke, my chauffeur can give you a ride to St. Paul if you need."
Luke nodded.
"I'll meet you outside then."
The goddess, in human form, bid a diminutive farewell to Annika and a more convincing, if still fabricated, appreciation for Natasha's coffee before stepping outside herself.
"Tosh, thanks," Luke began,
her arms wrapped around the slender column of his body.
"Are you kidding me? You saved our lives, Luke. Thank you feels like a childish thing for me to say."
"Oh, no, it isn't." Luke was still surprised by her third embrace in barely a day.
"Look, I'll call you later, okay?"
She pulled away.
"No, you won't. You'll get distracted."
Her expression was neither sad nor angry.
"And that's okay, Luke. It's part of who you are. That's the part of you I will always love."
She touched his cheek before picking up and handing Annika to him.
"I like Shelby more than the mean doggy,"
his daughter announced as he kissed her goodbye.
"Oh, me too, sweetie. Me too."
right, listeners. That's tonight's story on this rainy evening. I'm your host, Michael Strand, and you're listening to the Everlasting Stories podcast. You just heard Grendel's Ghastly Grandmother by D. Zane Davis, published by Six Emperor Serpent on the Everlasting Stories archive at patreon.com/sicksemperserpent. We will return, folks, next week with the third episode from the case files of Detective Luke Miller, titled Luke Miller and the Belligerent Bigfoot. It's great. You're not going to want to miss it. And head on over to patreon.com to catch every story we publish and every episode of the podcast. For a few bucks a month, you can get early episodes while supporting local Minnesota literature. And to those of you who support us, thank you. The text for this story and the audio for this podcast were produced by me, your host, Michael Strand, managing editor at Six Emperor Serpent. The writer for tonight's episode was D. Zane Davis, local English teacher and writer for Six Emperor Serpent. And finally, the publisher of this podcast was T. Martin Krause, editor-in-chief at Six Emperor Serpent. The music tonight was provided by Caitlin Shepherd, a.k.a. Binkadink. Check out more of her work over at binkadink.bandcamp.com.